Welcome to the Bible Study Hour. We are so happy to be able to share with you again this week, and we say thanks that you have joined us so that we can go through a study of God's Word again. We want to thank God in a very special way for making this possible for us to do, and we hope that you had a good week as you went through your personal, your individual Bible Study Hour. Now that we have come to share this together, I just want to say to you, open your hearts and your minds so that you can enjoy the study of God's Word, and all of us will be truly blessed. Blessed we are indeed, because we are happy this week to know that we have three of our pastors sharing in the discussion. On my right, we have Pastor Alden Mort, far right. Then, close right, we have Pastor Arton Wedderburn. And on my left, we have Pastor James Sunlin. Okay. These three gentlemen, along with me, Lorna Stevenson, will take us through aspects of the very special lesson that we have for this week. And we hope that, as I said before, we will all be benefited. We pause to say thanks to our sponsors here, Easy Deal Auto Sales and Tours Limited, located at 1139 Catherine Hall, Montego Bay. And we remind you that you may get them on the phone at 876-371-2804. We want to say thanks to all who have made it possible for us to share with you in this special deliberation. And at this point, we invite you to join us in our opening prayer as we ask God's guidance.
Our great eternal Father, we, your servants, come in your presence. We ask you for your Holy Spirit so that he will impart to us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, so that even as we go through this lesson, the viewers will come to know you better. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
For this quarter, the period of 3 months from April to June, we are looking at a set of lessons which focus on God's everlasting covenant. This week in particular, we zoom in on children of the promise, because within this covenant that God has made with mankind, there are several promises. We are looking now at children of the promise, and in our memory text, we have a promise that some of us might not be ready to link with the lesson that we are studying. But when we examine it carefully, we see how important it is in the context of this lesson. So the memory text, which is Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, and we are looking at the last part of that verse. It says,
Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world.
We need some link. Pastors, whoever will start, bring us in now with the link of children of the promise and God's everlasting covenant.
The children of Israel, descendants of Abraham, needed to have the assurance of God's presence, and it was uttered to Abraham, to his descendants, Isaac, Jacob, to the children of Israel. And this one in Matthew is Jesus saying it to his disciples. Yes. When he was about to leave earth. There is this concern that as human beings we have, will I succeed? Mm-hmm. Will I make it? Will mm-hmm. I be safe? Will I be okay? Mm-hmm. It's constantly in our minds because we really can't see the future. And the assurance that God constantly gave to his children from ancient times and to our time is that I will be with you.
Yes.
And if I have the assurance that somebody who I trust and somebody who is able to help me is going to be there, then that gives me some sort of peace
mm-hmm.
and assurance that I'm going to be okay.
Okay.
And that's what Jesus was giving his disciples.
Good. Is there any other, you know, expansion that we want to put on this memory text?
Let me see. In making the connection with the topic and the memory text.
Yes.
If you note, he says, the promise. It's not any promise, but a special promise. Mm-hmm. You know, this promise was made even in the Garden of Eden. It came down to Abraham and even to us. The promise is Jesus Christ. And he says, lo, I am going to be with you even to the end of the earth. So this promise, you know, it's because of him, because of Christ, that all other promises stand.
Thank you. Pastor, would you have a word for us with this?
Well, if we the lesson says children of the promise, and this particular verse in Matthew 28 seems far removed from whatever is going on between Abraham and God. But if we take time to think about it, all of God's promises did involve some children or another. The covenants that he made, the promise that he made to the woman is that her seed would bruise the head of the serpent, suggesting a child or suggesting children. The promise he made to Abraham was that he would get a son, including a child. The promise he made to David was that his sons would sit on the throne forever, involving a child. But all of these promises also had an inkling of impossibility about them. Where, how could I get a child when I am sentenced to die? That's for Adam and Eve. They saw themselves ready to die. How could I get a child, Abraham, when I am old, probably impotent, and Sarah is past menopause? Same thing with David. How can my son sit on the throne when we know what happened with all the kings, even to the place where Jeconiah was brought down to Babylon and God said, you will not even get any more sons. You will not sit on the throne again. Well, we know that after coming out of Babylon, no more king sat on the throne of Israel, but a son was to come. And this was the son of David, whom we know is Jesus. And for the disciples, for us today, we are all children of God. John says, as many as believed on him, to them he gave power to become sons of God. And the last promise that Jesus made before his ascension was that I am with you always, in the face of an impossibility. Jesus was supposed to be dead. Nobody was supposed to be serving any other king but the Roman emperor. But Jesus gave them the guarantee that he would be with them no matter what. And that's beautiful. The promise of God from Eve and Adam coming all the way down to Jesus.
Good.
He will be with us as his children.
Good. So this promise of God being with us is it's the assurance to us that any other promise that has been made, we're not leaving you out there to wonder whether it's going to, you know, come through or not.
Right. That's true.
God is saying, I will be with you to see to it that all of what I have said is carried through.
That's right.
So, in making these promises, we go back again to Genesis, where in Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 to 3, there's a lineup of things there, and God is saying something very special about being thy shield. Let's hear from Genesis 15, 1 to 3.
After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. Abraham said, Lord God, What wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir.
Well, it sounds like Abram was about to suggest some alternatives to God.
That's right. That's right.
But what is the significance of this particular promise that God said to Abram that he would be his shield?
He's full of fear. He feels somehow that what God promised is not working out. And I'm fearful that I'm not going to have a great big family as God had said in chapter 12. You know, I also feel scared because around me there are people who are not so nice. Mm-hmm. I have had some encounters already mm-hmm. with a few of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering how is it going to work out? And fear is part of our human experience. We
yes.
all go through some fear. And it's not a problem to feel some fear. The problem is when we dwell in fear
mm-hmm.
and we don't get over it.
Mm-hmm.
And God did not want Abram to dwell in fear, because fear is a negative emotion that harms us. And God is appearing to Abram to say, look, don't fear. I am your shield. I will defend you. I will protect you. And I will prosper you. You know, so no need to fear. And Abram was saying, Lord, but you have not given me any children. That's why I'm fearful that your promise is not coming through. I need to know what should I do.
Sounds to me as if Abraham was fearful for himself and for God as well.
Of course. But God, your promise is not going to come true. As you said, that's a challenge to your own character.
Yes.
You know. Yes.
Well, Pastor Pettibone, how important was this at this time? And Pastor Sundin did hint at it before, but that God should make this additional promise of being a shield to Abraham.
It's significant in light of what took place before Genesis 15.
Yes.
Genesis 14, there's a big war. Five kings came up and decided they're going to take Abraham's family.
There goes.
And at the end of it, at the end of the war, you know, Abraham rounded up his men,
mm-hmm.
his household, and you know, distributed them in bands and said, you go there, and let's fight and take back what is ours.
All right.
Which would be Lot, whom you refer to as his brother, who was really his nephew.
Yes.
But sounds like they have a father-son relationship
mm-hmm.
because God told Abraham to get out of his household, to get out of his family with his household, but Lot went with him. And Lot tagged behind Abraham like a son.
He took Lot.
Even though God never tell Abraham to bring Lot anyway. But here's what's funny. After Abraham would have come out of that battle, then God comes and says to him, I am your shield and your reward.
Yeah.
Remember that the chapter ended with Abraham being offered some kind of reward
mm-hmm.
for his exploits in war.
That's right.
To refuse them. And then God said
yes.
to him, I am your shield. And from what Abraham would have come out of,
mm-hmm.
the fact that God said, I'm your shield, should have struck something in his mind.
Mm-hmm.
I have come out of this with just a little band of men
mm-hmm.
fighting against five kings, successful, mm-hmm. not because of my own exploits, but because of the mercy of God.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Abraham should have been able to identify God's grace, and not just that, but God's provision. I am your exceeding reward.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Remember, he said, I don't want anything, just give me the guys. But mm-hmm. Abraham didn't have a guy of his own.
Yeah.
He even said to God, mm-hmm. the only person I have is this guy from Damascus,
mm-hmm.
Eliezer. I don't even ever hear from myself except one that is born in my house. As Pastor Sonlin said, Abraham seemed to have been saying, there's a problem here.
Yes, God.
I can't fix it in my position that I have. But God already gave him the guarantee. Man, I've brought you out of much more than this. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do this for you. I'm and your exceeding reward. And that's really awesome.
Yes.
That's really awesome. Yes. In light of what Abraham has come out of.
Yes. And what Abraham was putting before God was something that was, in his time, a kind of unacceptable arrangement.
Certainly.
But here God presented himself as a special shield. Seer needs a shield.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Pastor Maud.
And if you notice, God a personal, I am.
Yeah. Yeah.
Declaring that, Abraham, I am not going to leave you.
Yes.
I am going to go with you through all of this.
Mm-hmm.
And even in it, you can see, Christ in it.
Mm-hmm.
Because talking about shield, shield is there to protect. We have sinned against God. We have transgressed. But God is saying to us also that I am your shield.
Yes.
I am going to be your savior.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to protect you from the enemy. I am going to be the God that stand by, and I'm going to fight your battles. And so even when Christ was on the cross, he was there fighting for us. He was they did all manner of things, but he bore it all because he's saying that I am going to be your shield and your reward.
And your emphasis in the point you have made also takes us right back to the significance of the memory text.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Lo,
I am with you.
I'm with you always. Whatever the circumstance, I am there for you. So, having looked at that, now let's look at the section of the lesson that talks about the messianic promise. And we are going to be looking at Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, and also Galatians chapter 3, verse 29.
Genesis 12, verse 3 says, "And I will bless them that bless you, and curse him that curse you. And in you shall all families of the earth be blessed."
Mm-hmm. And Galatians 3, verse 29.
Mm-hmm.
"And if he be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise."
In our discussion of this covenant that God has made with his people, we have come up against this before, but as often as we come up against it, it just reminds us where we stand in this covenant arrangement. Because we start off by looking at Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, where God is promising that all families of the earth will be blessed.
Mm-hmm.
And then here is Lorna Stevens in a little corner saying, all families, does that include me?
Mm-hmm.
And then Galatians come forward to remind me.
Yes.
And I leave it there just at that word. Take it up for us, please.
If he be Christ. In other words, if you have received Christ in your heart, if you belong to Christ,
mm-hmm.
then you are legitimately a seed of Abraham,
mm-hmm.
Through the blood of Christ Jesus. In other words, I don't have to be a literal Israelite.
That's right.
I don't have to have the literal blood in my vein coming from the lineage of Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
But as long as I accept the seed of the woman who is Christ, accept him as Lord, then I am certainly an Israelite, spiritual Israelite. I'm a seed of Abraham, a child of Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that is superior to being literally a seed of Abraham.
All right.
Because there are some persons who are literal seeds of Abraham will not make it to heaven.
Oh, Lord.
Because they have not accepted the one who came to redeem them.
So that special blessing that was promised will miss them.
Of course.
Because.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
All right.
It is a spiritual blessing,
mm-hmm.
that one cannot avoid if you are expecting to receive the ultimate reward,
okay,
you have to receive that spiritual blessing, okay, by being adopted through the blood of Christ.
Thank you.
When you look at, you know, this promise,
I was amused a while ago when I saw both of you looking at each other.
Yes.
Who is going to talk now? Go ahead, Pastor Mort.
You know, when you look at this promise that was made to Abraham, it didn't focus on Abraham's family alone.
Right.
And I want you to take, you know, it was not about a promise to the Jewish nation alone, but it's a promise to every single one of us that is on planet Earth, that in Abraham, all in the seed, in Abraham, all of the earth will be blessed. And that as a result, that yes, the lineage of Abraham, Christ came through that lineage. Mm-hmm. And so Christ suffered and died so that all of us can get eternal life. And as a result of that,
mm-hmm,
we are part of that covenant. We are part of that promise that was made to Abraham then. And so we are rejoicing, you understand? Mm-hmm. Because that promise came down to us. And, you know, we are, put it this way, even though we are Gentile, we are engrafted in it. You understand? We are, as Pastor said, we are now spiritual. You know, we are now spiritual Israelite, and all of it is because of Jesus Christ.
Yes. I like to put these special little awkward questions, if you would call them that way, to Pastor Wedderburn. Because this promise we are emphasizing here was made to Abraham. Mm-hmm. But what about those families that existed before Abraham?
Well, Pastor Moore mentioned them, yeah, us being engrafted.
Yes.
They were supposed to become part of the family, mm-hmm, through a means called circumcision.
Yes.
That was the method of Abraham's household joining the covenant of God.
Mm-hmm.
We see this later in the Bible where Moses was going down to Egypt, mm-hmm, to raise the people out of Egypt. And then God withstood him to kill him, as it were.
Yes.
And then Zipporah just jumped up with a sharp stone and mm-hmm, circumcised the sons. The other individuals who were around were supposed to be brought in from the message that Abraham had.
Mm-hmm.
And them becoming part of the family of God would have been the early stages of reflecting to the world God's ultimate intention for Abraham. One of the things many people may have overlooked is that they see the blessings of Abraham sometimes as temporal blessings,
mm-hmm,
just see the material aspect of it. But we know ultimately it is Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
In Jesus' experience, they had a big old court argument about who's son. And you remember the,
yes,
argument? We are, mm-hmm, Abraham's seed, and the, mm-hmm, Jews shut it down and say, "You're of your father, the devil, because you do his works." They were blood lineage of,
yes,
Abraham, but they never accepted,
yeah,
whom Abraham was, well, not foreshadowing, but whom Abraham was supposed to precede,
mm-hmm, yes,
which is Jesus. Right. Abraham was the progenitor,
yeah,
of Jesus, and they didn't accept him. So with Jesus coming now, it shows that what Abraham was supposed to do was to bring everybody in.
Mm-hmm.
This is why Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Whether they are children of Abraham or they are children of the Gentiles, they can become sons of God,
right,
through me.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, for your deliberation. And we are going to be deliberating that point a little bit more, the messianic promise, when we return, because we take a short break now. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
Today I faced a mountain that I have no strength to climb. And the struggle of this journey leaves me weak in both body and mind. Where I stand to the peak is a distance on my own I cannot reach. So this journey of a thousand steps begins right here on my knees. Soon I'll soar like an eagle, high on wings of grace, far into the heavens, where I can almost see God's face, rising in His splendor, thank you Jesus, thank you Jesus. What once looks like a mountain, just a hill, from heaven's points of you. I may face things tomorrow that I can't comprehend today. Circumstances so uncertain makes it hard to find the strength to pray. But I'm living in God's promise. I'll never leave you, I'll always see you through. So what's this mountain to an eagle flying high from heaven's point of view? Soon I'll soar like an eagle, high on wings of grace, far into the heavens, where I can almost see God's face. I want to thank God, thank Him today. What once seemed like a mountain is just a hill from heaven's point of view. Soon I'll rise like an eagle, to God's heaven, where I can almost see God's face, rising in His splendor. What once seemed like a mountain, just a hill from heaven's point of view. What once seemed like a mountain, just a hill from heaven's point of view.
Welcome back to the Bible Study Hour. We are so glad that you have stayed with us, and we are pleased to share with you this week, as we have our pastors here with me. We have Pastor Mort, Pastor Wedderburn, and Pastor Sunlin. And as we share in God's word, we just want you to pick up from where we left off, because we're talking about children of the promise, and we had started talking about the messianic promise. Now we are looking at that same subtopic part two as we go a little further into our deliberations on this. So we ask you to take your Bibles and turn with us to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 to 18. That will be followed by Revelation chapter 3, verse 12.
For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
And Revelation 3 verse 12 says, Him that overcomes will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name.
It seems from these two passages that we have just read that we are taking a step forward from where we left off.
Just a step, but a huge
leap. A huge leap. Good.
Going up.
Good.
Going up.
So no matter how giant that step is, it's more than that.
Yeah,
more. All right. So, what else do we learn from this messianic promise as we have read from these two passages? Pastor Mort, you want to start for us?
Now, when you look at the world that we are living in, mm-hmm. and how sin, you know, has ravished this world, mm-hmm. We have seen crime and violence. We have seen robbery and, you know, all of it. And the blessed hope that we can accomplish through Jesus Christ to say that something better is coming. Mm-hmm. What a promise. And all of this is through Jesus Christ.
Yes.
All of it. And so, therefore, we are rejoicing, we are giving God thanks for this. Because even Thomas Browning says, to enjoy true happiness, we must journey into a very far country, and even out of ourselves. You see, in this life, we don't have, if it's in this life we have hope, we
only.
Would be men most miserable. But we thank God that there's a better promise that is coming. And this promise is that, hey, we are going to live with Jesus forever and ever and ever.
So 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 is not just a promise that is read at funerals, eh?
No.
It's something by which we ought to live.
Sure. It is a
take
promise.
Us up more on that, Pastor Sunlin.
Remember that we have strayed from God, mm-hmm. from the very beginning, Adam and Eve, and the generations coming down to mm-hmm. our time, constantly drift away from God, getting into trouble. As a matter of fact, if it weren't for God's intervention, we all mm-hmm. would have been annihilated already, would not last on the earth. But God's mercy has extended to all of us. And God's promise to Abraham to make him great, to multiply him and to bless him, God is thinking of more the deliverance from the mess that the world has found itself in as a people.
Mm-hmm.
And God's ultimate goal is not to bless us and leave us here.
Yeah. Okay.
His ultimate mm-hmm. goal is mm-hmm. to bless us and take us out of the sin-cursed earth, the environment.
And keep us totally blessed.
And keep us totally blessed. Okay. And that's his desire. Yeah. So he wants to take us home
mm-hmm.
and the blessing sometimes in the world is construed to be mm-hmm. material prosperity.
Mm-hmm.
While that is a part of God's plan, that's not the greatest part of it.
Okay.
He wants to get us out of this world. And so the promise of the coming of Jesus and the resurrection of the saints, the translation of the living saints, is God's ultimate plan to take us out.
I'm sure they have left something for you, Pastor.
Well, yeah, I would imagine.
Yes.
So they're kind gentlemen.
They can't exhaust this thing.
What jumped out to me, though, from Revelation is how we see God describing the fact that he would set the brethren of the Church of Philadelphia as pillars in the temple.
Yes.
When we consider this in light of what the patriarchs have been through and what God's children have been through, we see how significant and potent this is.
Mm-hmm.
Especially in light, if we were to keep it strictly to Jerusalem, the church in Jerusalem or the synagogue was going to be destroyed in AD 70.
Mm-hmm.
But let's not call him the synagogue, but the temples of the church around them, the temple of Aphrodite and the temple of Diana, those things would not be destroyed.
Okay. Right.
Even though we see relics of them, that Jesus himself said not even one stone will be left upon another for the Jerusalem temple. The children of Israel knew what disappointment was like. They knew what failure was like. Mm-hmm. Solomon built this grandiose structure, Nebuchadnezzar mm-hmm. came and burned it. They came back from Babylon, built up a thing, they even scorned it themselves. This doesn't even look right.
Mm-hmm.
And it was destroyed again. Herod came and built them another one, and then Titus came and destroyed it.
Mm-hmm.
And here God is saying, I am going to make you a pillar in my temple.
Yes.
You know that a pillar is something that gives support, it gives stability.
Yeah.
If no matter how big your structure is, if it doesn't have pillars, it's going to fall over.
Yeah. Yeah.
We Jamaicans who love crusades, you know that the tent needs pillars. And look what God is doing for his children. He's setting them up as pillars in his temple. Not only that, the Bible does say in Revelation 3, verse, let me find this verse right here. Those who, in Revelation 3, verse 10, because you have kept the word of my patience, I will also keep you from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them
mm-hmm.
that dwell upon the earth. God isn't trying to hide from us the fact that problems will come.
That's right.
He is open with us. And if we look at what this gentleman, Augustine of Hippo, wrote.
Yeah.
When I was reading, I'm like, oh my God, I don't know.
No,
it just keeps on getting worse and worse and worse. I didn't read all of it word for it because it was so distasteful. I didn't read all, it was so unfair. But that's the reality in which we live.
Yeah.
We live in a reality of a broken world, a broken system.
Yeah.
And even though the presence of Jesus is real,
mm-hmm.
so are the issues that we face.
Yeah.
However, as Pastor Moore so rightly said, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we have all been most miserable, which is why Jesus has promised us somewhere and something better, which is in the life to come.
Amen. Amen. So when we think of the messianic promise
mm-hmm.
here, we're not just thinking about Jesus coming to earth as a baby, Jesus living a life to show us how to live, Jesus dying on the cross, Jesus being resurrected. We're thinking beyond that.
That's right.
With Jesus and his atoning ministry for mankind and returning to receive us into his glories forever.
That's right.
Wow. It is a big picture, and may the Lord help us to understand it and really fulfill our part in that promise, because the promise is made to us as Abraham's seed. Ain't that something?
Yes.
And as we consider the promises in the covenant, and we look at the promise of a great and mighty nation, that was made to Abraham too as well. Yes. So let's see what is there for us in this section as we read Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6, and Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 to 3.
And the word of God says, "Now, therefore, if he will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then he shall be a particle treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And he shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and holy nation. These are the words in which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel."
Isaiah 60, verses 1 to 3. "Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. For the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising."
"I make of thee a great and mighty nation." Pastor Sunlin, start us off with Isaiah chapter 60. How does that blend into this wonderful promise?
Well, we know that the people of God have been broken up, beaten up, you know, taken away into captivity, as it were. They somehow lost hope, and God was saying to them, "Look, it's time to get up out of the dust. Your burden and your problems and the shadow that you're sitting under, it needs to go away. Get up now, rise and shine, because my glory is going to rise upon you. I'm going to just bless you, and even though darkness cover the earth, my light is going to shine on you, and the Gentiles are going to see something special that is happening to you. The brightness of my glory is going to be seen upon you." In other words, God wants to do something special, not only in the people's lives who lived in ancient time, mm-hmm. but in our time too.
Yes.
Wherever, whichever dispensation God's people are living in, God wants to shine his glory. And this glory represents his character. Mm-hmm. You know, his goodness, his grace, his loving kindness, his compassion. He wants to reveal that through us, just as he did with the people then. So it's a message of hope that the days of dull, shadowy, sad, mourning days mm-hmm. are about to go.
Mm-hmm.
And the days of hope and rejoicing have come. And that's the experience that we need to have.
So when this promise was made earlier on, mm-hmm. Pastor Mort.
Yes.
"I'll make of you a great nation. You're going to be a special nation." Mm-hmm. How does that now? How does that link with the call in Isaiah chapter 60, "Arise, shine"? Pastor Sunday spoke to that already, but add some more to it.
But when you look at the backdrop of even the call to be a great nation, when you look at it, you get an idea what God was doing. One, you see the people sin against God in the antediluvian world. And God made a flood. Then, once again, the children rebel against God at Baal. You know, Babel. And there, God, you know, confound their language. Now, God called Abraham and said, "Listen, I am going to make a great nation out of you." Put it this way. I am going to make you a nation of righteousness. You know, out of you, in your lineage, the Messiah will come. And so, therefore, as we look at this wonderful premise, you know, the light has come, and, you know, with the glory of God. Now, when you look at all of this, you see that, you know, God wants to make a nation of godly people, a nation that fear him, a nation that walk in his way, a nation that exalt him. And as we submit to Jesus Christ, as we allow him to reign in us, he says, "Listen, you shall be the head and not the tail." So I am saying that the Messiah will come, yes, but we have to allow him to reign in our lives. Because if you look at the promise, it did not fulfill, you know, in Abraham time, mm-hmm. nor in Isaac time, nor the great nation I'm talking about. You know, it's the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt that they start to, you know, recognize as, you know, a powerful nation. But as you go down through the history, you know, Israel continue to go after the other nation. And God is saying, listen, man, come back. I want to make you great. I want to accomplish my meaning to you. And so therefore, as we submit to God and allow the light of Christ to shine in us, then we're going to be that people that is, that people look upon and say, hey, you're a godly nation.
Do you think God was being discriminatory when he wanted to make this particular nation such a great nation and maybe turning his back on other nations?
I don't...
it's okay, it doesn't matter.
In this day and age, that's a big issue, discrimination. Everybody wanting to become a social justice warrior, and we want equality and equity, and we want... God wasn't being discriminatory, but he was being particular about his intention, because he did say of Abraham, I know that he will order his house after me, so that they will walk in my ways. He said that about Abraham. God calling Abraham from his household to become a great nation, as we said, it didn't happen in Abraham's lifetime, but it happened. What we should remember is under what context it happened. God called Abraham right after the Tower of Babel, when people would have separated with their different tongues and languages with their own ideas, which is why now we have such a plethora of views about the flood. We have the Epic of Gilgamesh, you know, we have all manner of stories about creation. In those days, the message or truth was passed down orally.
Yes.
Everybody left with their own perception and idea of God, which is why we have such diverse views of creation. Abram was called so that that message of creation, that message of truth about the real and living God, can be passed down. So, as God said to the children of Israel in Exodus 19, you will be a nation of priests. What do priests do? They represent God to the people.
That's right.
They stand in the gap between the people and God. And so Israel's purpose was not to be cordoned off from the world because you're special and better than anybody else, but to go out and spread their borders so that more people can.
So come. Gentiles will come to,
to
the light.
That's
right. Okay, good. And as we talk about great nation, let's just continue the great talk and talk now about the great name, because it's a part of the promise as well, make your name great. And we are looking at two passages now, which are Genesis chapter 11 verse 4 and Genesis chapter 12 verse 2.
The Bible says in Genesis 11 verse 4, and they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth.
Genesis 12 verse 2.
Yes.
And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing.
I dare say here that the source and purpose of greatness are important.
Sure.
Very important, the source and the purpose. In these two verses just read, what do we see as the difference in these, source and purpose?
Well, the first one we're seeing is where the people of the antediluvian world, post-antediluvian world, rather, the followers of Nimrod, who was a mighty man, they wanted greatness by their own plan, their own device. So they're going to make themselves great, and they're going to give themselves a name. I call that righteousness by works. So they were trying to do their own thing, as opposed to what God was able to do.
Okay?
Now, you see, the thing that we need to understand that greatness, the true greatness, is not in us. It's in Christ. It's in God. So, you know, when you look at these, you know, persons at the Tower of Babel, they were trying to be great and their, you know, their building and their accomplishment. But that is not greatness. That is just probably you achieve something. But God said to Abraham that I am going to allow you, I'm going to make a nation, a great nation out of you. In that, a nation that will spread the gospel, a nation that will exalt my name, a nation that will reach mankind, who are dying in sin. You are going to, spread the gospel so that they can be rescued. And that is it. And that's even as a church, we are called to do that. Jesus called the disciples to say, hey, rescue people. You understand? Go out there because they are going to be dying in their sins. And so God wants to, rescue. And so he's from the promise to make, Abraham a great nation, a nation that fear God, that reach the others, reach others who are dying in sin to come and know the true and living God.
Thank you so much, Pastor Mort. Pastor Wedderburn.
I just want to say four or three things real quick. When God called Abram to make his name great, Abram was living in a dispensation where, as Pastor Sonny said, everybody wanted to do something great.
Mm-hmm.
The funny thing is, some persons do something great and they go down in history, and they just stay in history.
Mm-hmm.
Abram, however, continues up to now.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at it, we know that three of the major religions or people groups trace themselves back to Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
The Jews, the Arabs through Ishmael, mm-hmm. and even we as Christians, mm-hmm. we know that Abraham is part of our heritage. The other guys who wanted to do something great, they are now in infamy.
Mm-hmm.
We have Cain, who killed a man. Mm-hmm. That was great, a great mistake. We have Lamech, who married two
mm-hmm.
women and killed a man who dissed him.
Mm-hmm.
Two great mistakes. We also have Nimrod and
mm-hmm.
Cush. Great establishment,
mm-hmm.
and God brought it to naught. But Abram, however, his greatness was in the fact that he obeyed God.
Yes.
And now Abram's name lives on forever. Even non-Christians know the name of Abram. The name of Cush and those men may be just confined to historians and what do you call those people? Archaeologists,
mm-hmm.
who study these individuals' great work. But because of Abram's faithfulness, he now gets international renown.
Mm-hmm.
As Christians, when we submit ourselves to God through obedience, we can expect that greatness will be part of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
But not just greatness to be recognized by men, but to be honored by God.
Amen.
And I like that statement on which you ended the comment
mm-hmm.
you made a while ago, Pastor Wedderburn, and all of the comments that have been made by Pastor Mort and Pastor Sunlin. We just want to thank you for this, and we wish we had more time to go more into this, because there is more to all of it. But we will do that another time. Just want to emphasize here, as we talk about the great name, that when we try to make a great name for ourselves, we are really trying to project ourselves and to give ourselves the glory.
Yeah.
But when God makes a great name for us, then all the glory is due to God. And we are just happy that we can study God's word from time to time, and that we can get lessons that were not so clear to us or that we had never seen before. And this week, as we complete this discussion, this study on the promises, the children of the promise, and we see how this blend into God's everlasting covenant, I just want to encourage all of our viewers that whatever we do, wherever we go, just remember that God has you in his plans, and that the promises that he has made it very, very clear that your responsibility, the conditions attached, are ones that you can meet, because he has promised to be with us all the way. Wherever we are, whatever experiences we have, he has promised to be with us. He will be with us always. He has not made these promises and left us to fend on ourselves. But he is a God who will shield us. He is a God who will look out for us. And his covenant is an everlasting covenant. God bless you as you go through this week. God bless you as you seek to learn more from His Word. We invite you to join us next week again as we go through the Bible Study Hour, and we invite you to stay close to God as you seek to learn more from His Word. We say thanks again to our sponsors, Easy Deal Auto Sales and Tours Limited, located at 1139 Catherine Hall, Montego Bay. And we say thanks to all those who have made this a possibility so that we can reach to you with this Bible Study Hour. Now, in closing, we ask you to join us in prayer as we say thanks to God.
Father in heaven, thank you for being faithful to us. Help us to be faithful to you. Thank you for the promises that you've made. Help us to hold on to your hands even when life becomes difficult. Establish us as pillars in your synagogue. Establish us as pillars in your temple, where we will live and reign with you forever and praise you for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.